Good. There it is. Good morning, Big House Church. Hey, it's Palm Sunday. This is the Sunday when Jesus entered into Jerusalem and the crowd was going crazy. A lot of them jumped in on the hype of Jesus coming into Jerusalem. They didn't know who he was necessarily, but they heard some things and they jumped in. But today, we're not joining the hype. As we gather together, like we're in, and we know why Jesus came into Jerusalem. We know what follows Palm Sunday. But today we celebrate his entrance, proclaiming that he's the one sent to save the world. So I want to welcome you to church. I have an expectation that God's going to speak to you, that he's going to meet with you. Like, it's not an accident that you're here. You're here on purpose and for a purpose. So I'm glad that you're gathering with us this morning. I want to welcome those of you who are gathering online. There's some people that we absolutely love who we know you can't get to a physical church, so we're glad that we could get to you in our little micro church in Greece. I want to welcome you guys as well, and so we're glad you're with us. So let me pray over our service. The expectation is that God will work, but the invitation needs to be from you. God, work in me. Say something to me. Meet me where I am this morning. So would you do that as we just prepare? Would you stand up, and we're going to worship right after this prayer. So I'm going to pray. I'm going to give you a moment here. So let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, we are your people gathered in this place for your name's sake, to bring you glory, to display who you are to the world around us. And we know in this place we need to see you clearer. We need to know you better. So would you meet us where we are? Would you ask God to meet you today in this service? We just proclaim that this is holy ground as we gather here. This ballroom turns into a sanctuary because the church is gathered. And you do what only you can do in our hearts and in our minds and flood it with the light of the gospel. Be over this service and working in the hearts of men, women, and children in this place for the sake of our souls. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. God bless you as you worship.
I search the world. Thank you.
Christ, my living hope.
the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Come on.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory.
Thank you, Jesus.
You are here. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Stop, you never stop, you never stop, you never stop, even when I see that you're working, even when I see that you're working, you never stop, you never stop, you never stop, you never stop working, even when I don't see it, you're working, and even when I don't feel it, you're working, you never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop. You are waymaker, miracle worker. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. My soul, my Savior God, to
So hard for us to fathom. I don't even think we're capable of fathoming your greatness, your glory, your justice, your peace, your love, all of these characteristics in one being that created every part of everything we ever known. God, we thank you for just being who you are, not only who you are, but who you are as a God who loves us intimately and wants to get to know us. And then takes it further and doesn't leave us where we are, but brings us to a point where we can be better than where we started. God is good. And all the time, God is good. God, we thank you so much for everything you have done for us. And in your name we pray, amen. Won't you turn and face your neighbor and say hi?
Well, good morning, Big House Church. Thank you, worship team. Welcome, Grant. We're so glad to have you here. What a phenomenal way to start our time together today. I was so excited driving to church this morning because I knew I'd get to see you all. And this is a family here at Big House Church. So if you're here visiting us, we hope that when you walked in, you felt very welcome and felt like you were part of a family. And that's what, if you're watching us online, come back to church because we'd love to hug on you as well and let you know that this place is a very welcoming place and it does feel like family here. So welcome to Big House Church this morning. We here, a core value we have here at Big House Church is to have our kids know what we do here in service. So our kids stay with us for worship, but it is time to excuse them. So if you are a child between 0 and 6th grade, we just want you to stand. Don't leave yet. We'd love for you to stand and pray over you before you go, but we have special things planned for you. We have a fantastic team of Big House Kids teachers that take great care of your kids. So if you've already checked them in, they can, after we're done praying over them, they can head back to class. If not, please stop by our check-in table and sign them in. But before you go, kiddos, we want to pray for you.
Yeah, so if you'll bow your heads, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for such a great group of kids here at Big House Church. Lord, we love them because you love them. We ask that you would give us, your church, the courage, patience, and wisdom to lead them up in the faith that they might never know a day apart from you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, kids, have a great time in class. Learn something about Jesus that you can tell your parents after. Have a lot of fun, and we'll see you soon.
If you are here visiting us for the first time today, welcome. We just want to invite you back. We always tell our visitors, give us 3 Sundays to see if Big House is a place that you'd like to call home. We'd love to see you again and get to know you a little bit. So please come back again, especially next week on Easter Sunday. We'd love to see you again.
And church, we've been talking about this for a while, but this week we just wrapped up quarter one of the 260 challenge, which means we're a fourth of the way through the year.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah. That's wild. So we are doing a reading plan. If you're not familiar, we are reading through the New Testament in 1 year. There are 260 weekdays in 1 year, 260 chapters in the New Testament. So we're reading a chapter a weekday. We're doing it together. We have opportunity to engage in this online together. If you're using the YouVersion app to read through this together, starting Monday, you have to re-download or rejoin the plan. And so if you want, church, take out your phone. You can scan this QR code right here, and it'll automatically add you to the quarter two of our 260 challenge plan. If you don't have the YouVersion app, it'll take you to where you can download it and then join. If you already have the app, you'll be able to download that, or you'll be added to it directly. So you can do that now, you can scan it, or you can obviously go to bighouse.church later and join as well. But we're in the middle of Hebrews, we're finishing that up, and we are starting the Gospel of Luke. So some great stuff. We'd love to have you join, and I'm having a great time with it.
Cool.
So absolutely. And then also that this Monday is our first Monday of the month, but because there's so much going on, men, we are not gonna be having our men's first Monday. And so we'll start that again May. We'll start that again in May. So no first Monday, but there is good stuff going on this week, including Good Friday. So we are having our Good Friday service at Glenlock Pines Golf Club. That's going to be at 7 p.m. That's our opportunity to reflect on the first part of the death and resurrection experience, with it, which is Christ's work on the cross. So we'd love to have you join us for that. It's going to be a sweet service.
And then we go through Friday to get to Sunday, and we are so excited to celebrate Easter with all of you. And last week, we challenged you to pray about who God would put on your heart to invite to church. We do believe we're living in the end times and that Christ could come back at any time. And so we have a job here to do while we're waiting for Christ to come back, and that's to lead others to know who he is. And what better way to do that than to invite them to Easter service? It'll be a service of hope and the change that God makes in our lives. And so we just want to encourage you this week to continually ask the Lord, who would he would put on your heart? There is someone that you know that does not know the Lord. And so who is that person or family? We want you to invite them. I'm very thankful that somebody invited this family to church. There's Pastor Ty and his older brother. And so a family invited them to Easter. And so I'm very glad that they did. So you could be that family in someone's life. You don't know what an invite will do to a person or their life. So pray about that this week. We will be ready for them next week. We're excited. We have lots of great things planned. So we encourage you, invite someone for Easter next Sunday.
Hey, and church, we want to pray over this service together. And as we pray, we have a few things that we have the privilege to pray for. One of those is what we just talked about, who we're going to invite to service next week. And so, like my mom mentioned, for some reason, people are more open to coming to church on Easter than they are the other 51 weeks of the year. And so it's our privilege to take advantage of that and use it to the best of our ability. So as we pray, I'd encourage you to listen to the Holy Spirit. If he's putting someone on your heart who you need to invite next week, listen to that and pay attention to that, because people are open to coming to church on Easter, and that one service can change their eternity. And so let's pray together. We're going to pray over that. We also have the privilege to pray over our guest preacher, Ed, and his wife, Julie. In addition to having a sweet and lovable son-in-law, they also get to serve with the Christian Missionary Alliance as the regional leadership couple for the region of Europe. And so that is an intense job that keeps them very busy. You'll hear more, a little bit more about what they do in a little bit, but we're going to pray over those things together. So if you'll bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to worship you. You are a great God, and you are a good God, and we love you, and we praise you, Father. We do, Lord, lift up this season of Easter, where we celebrate not just your death, but your resurrection, Lord. You're raising to life, which gives us the opportunity to not just have life, but to have it abundantly. And so, Lord, we pray over the people, Lord, who you want to meet next week, Lord. You have an appointment with people divinely picked out, Lord, and we just commit them to you, Lord. Give us here at Big House Church the courage and the boldness and just the ability to find those people, to create space to invite them next week. Lord, we pray for your Holy Spirit's presence, that you would fill this place, that they would meet you here, Lord, and that you would change their lives for eternity. So we commit that to you, Father. We also pray over Ed and Julie, Lord, in the work that they are doing in Europe, Lord. We pray that you would bless that. Part of their work is the opportunity to love on, to support, and to lead the Christian Missionary Alliance missionaries that you have in Europe. And so we pray for discernment for them. We pray for for them, so that they have the ability to encourage those around them. We also pray for your protection over them as they, over the next few months, go to some places in Europe that have been torn apart lately, Lord, that you would give them the opportunity to be your hands and feet. So we commit them to you, Lord. We commit this service to you. God, we're thankful for your goodness, and it's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Church. Hey, that invite picture that you saw, I was thinking through that picture, and I'm like, I'm pretty confident that we went to a Mormon church for Easter, because I was looking at our outfit, and we didn't go to church at all, so whoever invited us, my mom would have tried to reflect, like, who that was, and I'm like, that looks like a Mormon missionary, like two little Mormon missionaries going to church, so it could have been. So there's going to be competition for Easter. So invite people to Big House. That's my encouragement to you. This morning I have the privilege of introducing not only Steph's father-in-law, but I want to give you some insight into this guy. Oh, you can put that picture up right there. I became a Christian at 22 years old. Can I have this one back? Hold the microphone up higher. I became like, no, that's not what you're saying. I became a Christian at 22, didn't know much about anything. And Lisa said, if you're going to follow Jesus, you need to know him. And I'm like, where can I do that? And she goes, there's a school in Georgia. It's a Bible school. You should go to that. And I mean, I've been out of the house in 17, doing my own thing, like lost. And so she's like, you should go to this Bible school. And I'm like, okay, I'll go there. So I hitched a ride with a family I didn't know. I literally hitched a ride with a family I didn't know to go to a place I'd never been to learn about a guy that I just met. And that's what Toccoa Falls College is to me. It's holy ground for me because I found a place where I could go and learn about Jesus. Like, I was so excited to get to know this Savior who I had just met. So on that campus, like, I was looking for Jesus. And I'm looking for Jesus in the faces and in the lives of the people that I met. And so you can imagine, sometimes a Bible school is like a little bubble from the culture. And I couldn't be more excited that it was. Like, I got there, was refreshing. Like, there was not as much darkness in my life. I was surrounded by people who knew God and lots of kids who loved God and were pursuing God. And so in the faces of people, I was looking for Jesus. Well, the only thing I knew apart from just finding Jesus was how to play soccer. So I joined a soccer team. So you can bring up that picture. And so I joined the soccer team. That's me in the middle. I think I could have spread my legs further in that picture, but that's before they did man spread thing, and I didn't know it was illegal. And so that picture is me, and you see I'm sitting on the bench. That's where I stayed all season. Like, I was great. Like, that's one of the best things I could do is sit on that bench. But also on that team was another player. And so let's bring this dude up. There were players on there. Here's this dude right here. Rocking hey, high school kids, this is a mullet before you were even born. You're trying to bring that back? This is the original right here. Ed Mangham was on that team. And so we played soccer together for that year. But also, he became a friend. And we hung out together. And so there was one point, like, your life was in danger, and I saved your life. I don't know if you remember this or not, but could you bring this up? I don't know who captured it, but I literally, he was falling off a cliff, and I grabbed him. And he's the most congenial guy. His life was in danger, and he's still smiling. And I'm like, I will get you. I will save you. And so I saved him from falling to his doom and to his death. Or that was a post picture. We hung out together. This is our little group. I think we're standing on top of a car there. And I don't even know why. But Ed Mangham was in my life as one of the believers following Jesus. So I looked to and said, what does it look like to follow Jesus? Now, you may look around and think of your high school kids, your college kids, and there's some scrappy-looking kids in this place. But I want you to treat them well, because take a look at this last picture. You don't know how they're going to turn out. Like, if you look at that group, you'd be like, I'm giving up on the youth of America. I don't even know why Lady Freedom is being accosted, but there's Coke. It's American. I don't know what we're doing. I don't even know where that statue came from. But in that little mob, there's a future pastor and a future missionary who are at that time falling in love with their Savior, getting to know their Savior, getting to see their Savior, and getting to see their Savior in the lives of others. And so Ed Mangham has been a special part of my life. At that season of my life, I needed young men who knew Jesus. One last story. So after you can take that down. That's sorry, kids. Don't do that stuff. At one season of my life, as I'm getting to know what following Jesus looks like, we had a speaker, a preacher in one of our chapels, and he said, hey, you can't do this on your own. You also have the Holy Spirit to help you. And so you can ask the Holy Spirit and he will help you. And Ed, after that chapel, said, hey, Ty, have you ever asked the Holy Spirit to help you in your life? And I'm like, no, I've never done that. That sounds amazing. Like, I literally know so little. And so he's like, do you want to do that? I'm like, yes, I do. And so I figure he knows what to do, so he's going to, like, lead me in it. And he goes, let's go in here. And you brought me into a janitor's closet. We're like, let's go to this janitor's closet. And I'm like, oh, this is getting crazy, you know? And so he's about to pray and just invite me to pray to say, Holy Spirit, will you help me live out this journey? Because I can't do it on my own. And so we bowed together, just two college kids in a janitor's closet. And I asked the Holy Spirit. I expected, the bottles to explode. Like something crazy is going to happen in here. And nothing crazy happened. Nothing manifested. I didn't know what to expect. But I can tell you this. My life after that moment, Ed, of you having the sensitivity to say, hey, you're going to need the Holy Spirit in this journey, changed forever. It was just different. And I want to encourage you, you're looking to people around you to see Jesus. Look for people who will show you what he looks like and who will lead you faithfully to who he is. That forever changed my life. We didn't know that 21 years later, or 30 years or whatever it was, 25 years later, I get a phone call from my son, and he's like, hey, Dad, because Seth went to Tekoa. He said, do you know any Manghams? I'm like, I do know one. He's a weirdo. He's crazy. But why? Well, I really like this girl, and her dad is Ed Mangham. And I'm like, no way. We went to school together. We played soccer together. And then they fell in love together, and they got married. And God brought it all the way around. And now Seth is your son-in-law, and Madeline is my daughter-in-law. We sure did not see that as we were traveling around Tekoa and wreaking havoc on that small little town. So I want to invite Ed Mangham to come up here, give us the word.
Thanks, brother.
Yeah.
Is this attached?
You want to read my notes?
No, I don't. Okay.
I made some for you right now.
Have you ever met someone who loved Jesus so much it made you feel uncomfortable? That was Ty back at Tekoa. Well, thanks for that introduction. My name is Ed. My wife is with me, Julie. We serve with the CMA in Europe. Leading our missionaries and our projects. But this year, we're in the States doing our home assignment. Yeah, this is kind of a picture of, that's where we have projects and give you a little bit of an idea. So we're in the States this year on what we call home assignment. We do this every fourth or fifth year, living in Kentucky. And we don't live too far from Asbury Seminary. And university. Anyone here watching or have seen things that have happened in Asbury this year? Yeah, so we're pretty close to that. And, you know, if you live around that school, you know, revival is a part of their culture, and they pray for it a lot. So when that began to happen on the 8th of March, was it? We were in Europe, traveling around for a 3-week mega trip, and we missed most of it, except that my parents, who are almost 80, were there for 12 hours a day at the altar, praying for people, and so they kept us informed of all that God was doing. And I only bring that up because since then, it's become apparent to me that God is really meeting people these days. It's like the space between heaven and earth is thinner for some reason. And so as I speak this morning, I want to let you know that that for you to pursue God in these days, you're liable to really meet him in a unique way. So that's my prayer for you. It's my prayer for me, that God is meeting his people uniquely these days. A friend of mine spoke at a pastor's conference in Washington State, and one thing he tells me is, I do not do altar calls. No way. That's like, he doesn't like to do that. He says, I'm a wholesale preacher. I'm not a retail preacher. I don't know what that means, but he doesn't do altar calls. I said, Matthew, when you speak, you don't have to do an altar call, but just invite people to meet with God. And so he called me, and he was crying. He said, Ed, there were 3,000 pastors there. He said, I invited people to meet with God, and for the next 3 hours, 400 pastors lined up to be prayed for. God is doing something special these days. So I just say that. We started this new job in Europe. Before that, I worked in a district office. And before that, I was a pastor. Before that, we worked in Jordan, in the Middle East, for 11 years. But before we started this new assignment as regional leadership couple, August 2019, my wife and I and our son, Tate, who is our youngest, we all left our house in Wilmore, Kentucky, and moved to southwest Germany in a little village called Condern. That's where our regional office is located, and we began to lead our people we didn't know very well, doing projects we didn't know about too much, but we started our work. About 100 missionaries, most of our missionaries plant churches across 12 countries, from Portugal to Moldova, you know, right across Europe, from Paris to St. Petersburg. And just as we got started in our work, remember, this is August 2019, the whole world began to change. Remember what happened just after that? I don't know if you remember, but not long after we moved to Germany, a virus broke out. Yes, a virus. And for us in Europe, starting in March of 2020, day after day, countries in our region slammed their doors shut. So how do you lead missionaries you've never met in person when you can't get to them? How do you lead places that you've never been to? Our work reduced to nothing but office work and video calls, and it became the worst version of that job that we could have ever imagined. And I have to admit, there were times when my wife and I would look at each other in the eye and say, why did you let me say yes to this job? We never signed up for a life on Zoom. We didn't even know what that was. And the reality was, most of the missionaries who served in our region were asking similar questions. Questions like, how am I supposed to plant a church in Paredes, Portugal, or Madrid, Spain, when we can't leave our apartments? What are we supposed to do when all of our in-person ministries are shuttered? Maybe you had some of those experiences, except Texas. You know, you march to the beat of your own drum here. Amen. Come on now. So what does it mean when God invites you into a season of profound difficulty? When it feels the cost of the Christian life is high? When nothing feels easy, when the tides feel like they're flowing against you, and yet it's in the eye of the storm when you experience the deepest encounters with God. You know, I'm having a conversation with Aubrey, a guy I never met before, and immediately I begin to hear about his story of immigrating from South Africa. I promise you, it was an experience that kept him up at night with anxiety and worry and trouble and loss. And yet it was a story where God encountered you and your family in an amazing way. The Bible describes that kind of experience. It describes that kind of life as the way of the cross. Now, for this message, I'm really kind of talking to the Christians among us. If you're not a Christian yet, allow me to speak to the believers. I think you'll learn something too. So in the next 25 minutes, I'm going to invite us into that kind of life, the way of the cross. Here's my thesis. Here it is. Unless God has all of you, not all of you corporate, all of you individual, unless God has all of you, unless you are fully surrendered to him, he will not do all he wants to do in you and through you. I'll say it again. Unless God has all of you, unless you are fully surrendered to him, he will not do all he wants to do in you and through you. A few weeks back, I texted a pastor friend of mine who's Arab. He lives in an Arab country, and it's a country that doesn't allow you to convert Muslims. And yet, he's planting churches there. And so he's acquainted with the troubled life in the work that he does. And I texted him, all I said was, y'all doing okay? I actually said y'all. I said, y'all doing okay? I'm reading my text right here. And then I said, how can we pray? And within a few minutes, he gave me a voice message back.
مرحبا Ed, كيفك؟
It's a greeting.
Yeah, we're doing fine. Not great, but fine. Thank you for asking. Actually, the bank, because I write checks for my wife to get some cash from my account in the U.S. for the ministry, and the bank froze the account. Now I'm dealing with that, so you can pray for that. I don't know why they froze it, but it seems they are running after us. Last week, Sunday, a sister was interrogated, and on Thursday, they threatened her for a second interrogation. She has to confess, or they will give her a hard time. Lots of things we get reported in the South. One of the brothers basically reported all of us. Yeah, lots of items. Pray for us as family.
Of course, this is nothing new for him. He has spent a lot of time in interrogation rooms, harassed for his active faith in Jesus and the work that he does. And so the question is, how does a guy like this operate day to day with a steady hand and a steady heart? So to find an answer to that question, I want to take us to Jesus' words in Mark chapter 8. Don't go there quite yet. It's really going to be a focus on Mark 8, and don't bring it up here yet. Mark 8, 34. But I need to warn you before we go there. I need to warn you, especially if you're comfortable in your Christian life, these words of Jesus could feel heavy and hard. And for you youth, I'm a little concerned about you with this passage. Especially if you're considering saying yes to Christ or a life of ministry, that the words of Jesus might frighten you off. But if the Lord will help me, my prayer is that you will understand that God has a different spiritual economy. While we see the finite, he sees the infinite. And his desire is that you will really grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the measure of all the fullness of God. And that the only way you're going to find that kind of life is found in Mark 8:34. Here's the stage. I want to set it. The book of Mark, New Testament book, the disciple Mark's biography of Jesus. And so by Mark chapter 8, Jesus was in the thick of his public ministry shortly before Palm Sunday. He's fed 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And he's fed 4,000 people with 7 loaves of bread and how many fish? It says a few. So when you're a first century Galilean, that's the kind of leader worth following, okay? He's driving out demons now. He's giving sight to blind people. He's opening the ears of the deaf. He's opening the voice of the mute. And despite Jesus's humility and despite his efforts to keep his miracles secondary to his message, Jesus is growing in popularity by Mark chapter 8. Crowds were following him by this chapter, and this was all feeling very good to the disciples. This is what they were waiting for. You get the picture? It was very easy and good and exciting to follow miracle Jesus. The disciples and the crowds were leaning in, eager to be aligned with Jesus of Nazareth. So it was into this season of ministry, a season that would take Jesus all the way to Palm Sunday and on all the way through Passion Week and right to the cross, right to the grave, right to the resurrection, that Jesus calls the enthusiastic and supportive crowd and his starry-eyed disciples, and he tells them all about the way of the cross, about the cost of following him. So these words in Mark 8 are some of the most important words in the New Testament, about what it means to be a follower of Jesus, a disciple of Jesus, an apprentice under Jesus. So here it is, Mark 8:34. Then he called the crowd. He called the crowd to him along with his disciples. Let me stop there real quick. Don't miss this, because what Jesus is about to say is a message not only for the 12, it's a message for the crowd. For everyone considering the Christian life, one of the worst heresies in this last century for the church is the hell insurance Christianity, that if you simply pray this prayer, you're all set for heaven. And you can live your life any way you want to after that. A.W. Tozer, back in 1955, a great author, wrote, "Believing for salvation has these days been reduced to a once-done act that requires no further attention. The young believer becomes aware of an act performed rather than of a living Savior to be followed and adored." And what Jesus is saying is very different. So here's what Jesus says then, and here's what he says now. He says this, okay, crowd and disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple, they must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. Jesus doesn't stop there. He doesn't just give us command. He gives us incentives or reasons, and you see those in verse 35 and 36. He says, whoever wants to save his life, whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever wants to lose their life for me, for the gospel, will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? So let me take a closer look at verse 34. Whoever wants to be my disciple. In fact, in the original language, it actually says, in English, we've sort of changed it because we don't like repetition in writing. But the actual original text says this, whoever wants to follow me must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. Get it? It's like he's saying, if you're going to follow me, follow me. There are three quick truths I want us to see in this very important verse. It's, number one, it's a singular call. This invitation is both to the crowd and to the 12. There are not two levels of invitation. Jesus is not offering one level to the serious Christian and one level to the regular Christian. Everyone gets the same call. It's the same standard. He calls high school kids. He calls school teachers. He calls business owners. He calls presidents. He calls McDonald's employees. And pastors. In our region, I'd love to introduce you to Mike and Leah Strand. Mike and Leah, Mike was an IT executive, and they felt a call, they're kind of our age, felt a call to give their lives to missions. So they left Wisconsin and set aside those things. And now they serve in Sarajevo, Bosnia, and Herzegovina. I'd also like to introduce you to the Nicholases. Ernie and Sharon had a successful company, family business in Warren, Ohio. Now they serve North African immigrants and international students in Malaga, Spain. Or I could introduce you to the Scots. They just sold their cabinet-making company in Wisconsin last year. They're in their 40s, are in their second year of language school studying, of course, Armenian. Or Albanian, actually. Harder language. Because they want to open a community center in Pristina, Kosovo. No, we don't all get called to the mission field, but he does call us all to say this. He calls us all to say, God, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I'll give whatever you want me to give. I'll serve whoever you want me to serve. I'm 100% yours. So this call of God, this call that Jesus makes is a singular call for all of us. Number two, is that the cross of Jesus that he's asking us to take up is impossibly difficult. Remember, Jesus' usage of the cross as a symbol in this verse is before his own crucifixion. So his hearers don't have the benefit of knowing the connection with the cross and Jesus. Had he said this a few weeks later, after his death on the cross and the resurrection, it may have made more sense. It may have been more clear to the crowd and the disciples. They may have understood what he was saying more clearly. But as it was difficult to hear. So what do we know about the cross? Of course, we all know that it was an instrument of execution, kind of like a electric chair or a gallows for, you know, whatever. Except that a cross was not hidden behind prison walls. It was meant to draw out execution. Piper describes the cross in four ways. He says it was a symbol of official public opposition against a criminal. Official public opposition. It was also a symbol of shame. It was designed to be the most shameful death possible. Like I said, it wasn't an execution behind a prison wall. It was the cross was often set on a crossroads or on a hilltop for all to see. The victim was stripped naked, and that was their experience, shame. The cross was also meant for unspeakable suffering, and it always led to death. And so what Jesus is saying when he says we need to take up our cross is, if you want to follow me, Christian, are you willing to be officially and publicly opposed? I don't know about you, but in our country alone, Christianity is not the home team anymore. Are you willing to be publicly opposed? Are you willing to be shamed? Are you willing to endure unspeakable suffering? Are you willing to face death for me? If you are, you can be my disciples. Notice Jesus says that we do this for him and for the gospel. So Jesus is not asking us to be willing to suffer for no reason, for suffering's sake. It's for an intensely important reason. The third point I want to bring up is once Jesus says that if we want to follow him, we must deny ourselves. What does that mean? I think it's simple. Just as I look in my own life, the self does not like the implications of the cross naturally, right? It doesn't like official opposition, or it doesn't like shame or suffering or death. So what self should we deny? It's like Jesus is saying that we have two selves at play, the old and the new. And the old one is saying, Ed, you need to be prepared for retirement. You need to have things set right. You need to be comfortable. You know, after all, your work is hard. You need to have your ducks in a row. You need to have things settled. You need to be close to family. You need to be mindful of the needs of your kids and all good things. You need to insulate yourself from the troubles of the world. You need to be ready for retirement. And Jesus is telling the new one to deny the old one. You might be saying to yourself, I thought this was supposed to be a missionary message. Where are all the good missionary stories? My humble answer to that question is that as I honestly am feeling like these days ahead will be serious days for the Christian. You getting that feeling? A friend of mine was listening to a guest preacher from China, an underground church pastor, and he was talking about how the church functions in times of persecution. And his answer to that question, the pastor says, when real persecution comes to the church, three things will happen. Number one, every day becomes the Lord's day. Every house becomes the church. And every Christian becomes the pastor. Isn't that cool? In persecution, every day becomes the Lord's day. Every house becomes the church. Every Christian becomes the pastor. Again, I'm feeling that the church in the West is entering into very serious days. We've been telling our missionaries across Europe, missionaries, if you knew that the Lord was going to return within the next 12 months, how would that shape your ministry? That's what we're telling them. I'm telling them, I don't care what strategy you've committed yourself to, what buildings that you're renting, what buildings you've purchased to operate all these programs. If they are not pointing to a returning Jesus, get rid of it. I'm asking myself the same question. I'm asking Pastor Ty the same question. I'm asking you the same question. If you knew Jesus was returning within the next 12 months, how would that shape you and your life? Again, I'm preaching to myself as much as to you. We're so prone to have one foot in Jesus and one foot in the world. The old self is allowed to live alongside the new, and we bounce back and forth depending on where we are and what we want. The Bible calls this having a divided heart. And it's so clear that from the very beginning, this spiritual dysfunction has plagued God's people. Look at some of these verses. 1 Kings, God spoke, don't look at these. I'll just read them to you. 1 Kings 18. Elijah came near to all the people. Here's a prophet. He brings all the people. These are God's people. And he says, how long will you hesitate between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal, follow him. Don't be stuck in the middle. And then Jesus says to Isaiah, he says, these people draw near with their words and honor me with their lip service, but they remove their hearts far from me. In other words, on the outside, we play Christian, and on the inside, we are the Lord of our hearts. Again, Tozer, this author, says, in every Christian heart, there is a cross and a throne. And the Christian is on the throne till he puts himself on the cross. If he refuses the cross, he remains on the throne. Perhaps this is at the bottom of the backsliding and worldliness among gospel believers today. We want to be saved, but we insist that Christ do all the dying. No cross for us. We remain king within our little kingdom and wear our tinsel crowns with all the pride of Caesar. But we doom ourselves to shadows and weakness and spiritual sterility. End quote. Does any of this ring true for you? I'll tell you what, it changes how I spend my time. It changes my sense of urgency. It affects my spiritual disciplines. It shapes my attitude towards Julie, to my kids. Man, I know it when I have a divided heart. Don't you? It creates such a disillusionment in my soul, a confliction in my heart. It creates like a spiritual anxiety that I hate. On the other hand, have you ever met someone who is single-minded for God, who travels the way of the cross with grace and a smile, someone who has denied themselves? They've taken up their cross daily, and they follow Jesus. You know them when you see them. I want to tell you about Mike and Joanne Hope, a very ordinary couple, not too far away from retirement. I think I have a picture of them. Yeah. Right before Christmas, I went on a trip to Poland. Mike and Joanna work in Kiev, Ukraine. And as their leader, we're really dialed into the circumstances in and around the capital city. And they're not spring chickens. So when you have air raid sirens every day and your electricity goes out and your water goes out and there's stress and you've got people in the church who are affected by war, it's not easy for them. And so when I heard that they were coming out of Ukraine for a week in Poland, I quickly flew there to look them in the eye. And I was really prepared for my time with them. And I looked them in the eye and I said, Mike and Joanne, let's think about another assignment. I said, here are two options. Right here in Sandomir, and that's where we were, a beautiful little village and near the Ukrainian border, right here in Sandomir, it's like the center for logistics to gather supplies so that the president of our church network in Ukraine comes every month and takes back stuff. So it's a great place for you guys to settle in. You can support the Ukrainian church from Poland. You could really help him really build out this system of supplying the needs of the churches in Ukraine. Wouldn't this be great? You could just live here. Or you could live in Krakow, Poland. We have a new church plant there from one of our Ukrainian pastors. He's out in Krakow, Poland. And it's a great place. You could help out with a church plant like this. And they looked at me and said, please send us back to Kyiv. Well, I had a second plan. Because the president of our network in Ukraine was also there. And I took him and I said, Sergey, I have a great idea for the Hopes. Right here in Sandomir, they could help you with the logistics of bringing supplies in and out of Ukraine. You need help here, and you could see them every month. Or we could put them in Krakow, Poland, and they could help with the church plant there. After all, they need help with that church plant, don't they? And he looked at me and he says, please send the Hopes back to Ukraine. He said, our pastors trust them. They're such an encouragement to our people. You know them when you see them. I want to wrap this up with this. Here's my simple missionary message. This world needs a church that walks the way of the cross. We need young people who decide to be single-minded, no more divided heart. Young people who will deny themselves, take up their cross, and apprentice under Jesus. The only way we're going to make it, folks, is if we become wholehearted followers of Christ. In some sense, I'm here representing the missionary task. Yes, I'm representing our projects across Europe. I'm representing our new church plant in Portugal, our plants among North African immigrants right across Spain. I'm here representing our church planting effort in Bordeaux and Paris. We need someone to join our team in Milan, Italy, to reach the diaspora. We're dying for people to join our vibrant ministries in Kosovo and Bosnia. I wish I could take you to meet our students in Moldova. Tbilisi, Georgia, we need people to join us. We're desperate. We're not even close to keeping up with attrition. But what I've learned, listen, what I've learned is we only want Mark 8 missionaries. But for a moment, let's forget about Europe. What about Houston? What about Spring? Spring needs Mark 8 Christians. They don't need the other kind. Single-minded, fully surrendered, cross-carrying, self-denying followers of Jesus. The opportunities are endless. We walked around the old Spring yesterday. I don't know why I go back to that place. We walked around there, and it's amazing how open people are to experience something greater, something to experience God. There was a lady who's Turkish, sells Turkish things, and I went in there, and I thought, is she really Turkish? And I waited to hear her on the phone, and sure enough, she spoke Turkish. And so we walked up to her, and we said, you know, we know how much Turkey is suffering from those earthquakes. Do you have people connected to those who are affected? And she said, no, we're from Istanbul, but we have family who have connections who've been lost. And we were the only people in there, her shop, and tears began to come down her eyes as we began to empathize with the pain. I said, it must be difficult to have two hearts. And she said, what do you mean? I said, when people come in and you want to be a good store owner and your smiles and you're welcoming, and at the same time your heart is broken. Oh my goodness, she broke down. Tender-hearted. We said we would pray for her. Then we were at a restaurant and the waitress comes over, and I was embarrassed because we didn't order a lot. We weren't very, just Seth was hungry. So she knew we weren't going to give a huge tip, although that changed. So we ordered this little snacks and stuff, and I said, I'm sorry, we're not ordering much. I said, but we're here just to be with you. I don't know why I said that. She said, I can't tell you how much that means to me. And I said, why does that mean so much to you? She said, I lost one of my best friends last night. Big tears come. A waitress in the middle of lunch. Tears coming down her face. I said, if we could pray for you, how would you have us pray? And she, what was her? Just pray for strength, because she lost her friend, murdered in Lincoln. And I confirmed it on the news. We thought, this girl is either scamming us, but it was true. The opportunities are around us, and this city needs Mark 8 Christians. I preached this message a couple weeks back in Lexington, and after the service, I was standing in the lobby. I know these kids want to come in. And a young Asbury student who stood probably 6'10", walks right out of this crowded lobby, right to me, tears running down his face. And he says, what am I supposed to do now if I give my life to God in this way? And I was kind of struck by his question because maybe I hadn't given an answer. But God whispered the answer to me. And if you're asking the question, here's the answer to you. I told the young man two things. I said, you tell God that you want to follow him with self-denying, cross-carrying surrender. You tell him that. And then you ask the Holy Spirit to fill you up, to give you the power to live that kind of life. And right there in this crowded lobby, I placed my hand on his shoulder, and we prayed together. Maybe that's the prayer you need this Palm Sunday. And as we celebrate with the kids coming in, it will be a fun event. But if your heart is longing to encounter God, don't let this day pass you by. And after the service is done, I'm going to linger up front, and I'm happy to pray for you. Because it wasn't long after Jesus spoke these words in Mark 8 that he marched into Jerusalem on a donkey in Mark chapter 11, when the crowds cheered him on and shouted, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of Father David. Hosanna in the highest of heaven," they cried. What they didn't know is that the kingdom he was bringing would require Jesus to first walk the way of the cross. And so, Lord, I know you want to meet with your people. You are ready and waiting. And I ask that you would give your presence to us in a special way. We love you. And we're already grateful for what you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Maybe if I try. Oh, there we go. All right. Awesome. How cute were they? I love it. It's such a blessing when kids, I know, like, I can remember as a kid being just like, do I have to do this? And then, like, looking up and my mom just being, like, almost in tears. And I'm like, I'm just waving a thing around. But, man, what a blessing. Well, hey, actually, before we go into this song, I'd like to pray for us one more time. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for being who you are. Thank you so much for what you've done for us. Thank you for the kids, and thank you for just being who you are, God. I pray that as we respond to you, God, that that our hearts would be fully in this, God, that we wouldn't be double-hearted, but God, that we would be here of one heart, of one mind for you. In your name we pray. Amen. I give you my life, I give you my trust, Jesus. And you are my God, you are enough, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. My heart is yours, my heart is yours. Take it all, take it all, my life in your hands. My heart is yours, my heart is yours. Take it all, take it all, my life in your hands. Down my life, I take up my cross, Jesus. You are my God, whatever the cost, Jesus. Oh, Lord.
missionary message. That's for the missionary to come in and encourage the Christians to support missions. That's how it used to go. Until we find ourselves surrounded by a need for missionaries everywhere around us. So receive this message from a couple who have said yes to Jesus and certainly have surrendered to him, who have eyes on the front lines of where the gospel is pushing into. Receive that message, because the people around you need you to be the gospel message to them. You are the missionaries. You are the Christians. And you are the ones who bring Jesus to the people around you. Have a heart for it. So I want to end with a memory verse that I chose for this month. And it's wonderful how the Holy Spirit works. Because we finished our year of memorizing once a month. And so this week I was like, should we continue? And the Holy Spirit was like, yeah. But I want you to continue in the places that you're reading. So we're reading in the Gospel of Luke starting on Thursday. And so I went through the Gospel of Luke and I'm like, verses, what do you want us to have for this month? And this was the verse that the Lord gave me for us to memorize. And the message of the cross is like, we need people surrendered, denying themselves, picking up their cross, and following Jesus wherever he leads you. And this verse is Jesus' plea to the church. There are waitresses around you. There are shop owners around you. There are neighbors around you. There are family members around you who are tender-hearted and need to hear about Jesus. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers, they're few. So pray to the Lord of the harvest to send forth workers. And so in combination with that, and I know where I'm sending you to read in our 260 challenge is Hebrews 11, which is the heroes chapter. These are the people who denied themselves and followed God no matter what the cost. That mix is not by accident. We are to be a church that is sold out for the gospel and that is sent out for the gospel. That's all we can be. So if that message, like I'm going to pray for, like we're going to say this statement together, and then I'm going to pray to send you out as the gospel. If that's a message that you'll receive, I just want you to raise your hand so I see you as your pastor. If that's something you're saying yes to Jesus, like I'm in and I'm available to him. Not I'm in for the first time, like no, this is not church. This is not play church. This is like I'm going. And I'm in. Yeah, thank you. When we say this verse together, then let your heart bend toward answering it. I'll be a worker in the harvest. I'll be an answer, Jesus, to the prayer you tell us to pray. So let's read this together. This is the verse that we're committing to memorizing. Let's read Luke chapter 10, verse 2. Jesus told them, the harvest, the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. And so as your pastor, I send you. Respond to what the Lord has told you. I send you out in the love of God to be the love of God to those around you. I send you out to bring the kingdom of God to the places around you, to the people around you. For you are sent out on mission to be workers in the field that God has prepared for you to be a part of the harvest. For you to collect what God is doing in the lives of others. So would you be available? For you are sent out in the name of the Father, for the sake of the fame of his son Jesus, and empowered by the Holy Spirit to go In Jesus' name, go. Amen. Church, you are very loved. Thank you, Ed, for sticking around. And if you want prayer or talk, let's go up.